If you got your Bibles, turn to 2 Timothy, please, chapter number 1. I want to speak this morning about mothers. Second Timothy chapter number 1. If you will let me, I'm going to have a little introduction. You Bible teachers and adult teachers, I'm going to give you a series right here you can teach, okay? Four things you can teach about the home. And I'll give you the introduction. I'm going to give you the bone. You'll have to put the meat on it, all right? Number one, and I'm talking about mothers, and I'll get down to that in just a moment and read this passage. Number one, marriage is the heaven of the home. Amen. Let me say that again. Yeah. Marriage is the heaven of the home. Amen. See what you mean by that? Marriage was designed by God. God took man and made him, and took female, made her. I'll be honest with you. I'm real disappointed today as pastor this week. You know, politics make you do anything. And political expediency will make you do anything. Firing up your base, it disappointed me and actually disgusted me. That the leader of the free world chose to say that marriage is not only for a man and a woman, but he believes in same-sex marriage. Now, I know he's always believed that. He did in 96, left it in 2008 because he wanted to come to the center. Shame on him. I want to tell you this, the Bible is plain, the design of God. And I'm not being political this morning, I'm being biblical this morning. Marriage is between one man and one woman. Marriage is God's will, God's design. Marriage is a heavenly thing. And I heard this week that, you know, it really, you know, I'm not trying to get off on a tangent. I'm just telling it like it is this morning. Heard this week that there was no New Testament scriptures that condemned homosexuality. That is just not true. Romans chapter 1 says it's unnatural. Not only is it not against God's design, it's against nature. It's unnatural for man to be lie with mankind. It's unnatural for woman to lie with woman. It's unnatural. It's unseemly. And the Bible even goes so far to say it's a reprobate. Yeah. Right. Amen. Amen. That's all I'll say about that issue. Not only is marriage the heaven of the home, fathers are the head of the home. Thank God for that. Thank God for dads. You are the head of the home. That doesn't mean that you are smarter than your wife, because I know better. It doesn't mean you're better than your wife. I know better. It doesn't mean she's not equal to you. I know better. It only means that God placed you in his design as the head of the home, and that is your responsibility. And I'll jump to the fourth one, then go back to the third one. Children are the hope of the home. By the way, children are the hope of our nation. And I believe we ought to try to raise up a new generation of champions for Christ. But this morning, I want to speak about mothers. They are the heart of the home. And I want you to look at 2 Timothy. Paul speaking to this young preacher, and he's giving him exhortation, and he brings up the faith of his grandmother and the faith of his mother. And this morning I want to talk about the faith of mothers. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, according to the promise of life which is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my dearly beloved son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God whom I serve from my forefathers with pure conscience, that without ceasing I have remembrance of thee in my prayers night and day, greatly desiring to see thee, being mindful of thy tears, that I may be filled with joy when I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, and I am persuaded that in thee also. Wherefore I put in remembrance that thou stir up the gift of God which is in thee by the putting on of my hands. For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Mothers, the heart of home. I was sitting there, I'll be honest with you, I'm a little emotional today, more so than normal. I visited my mother Friday, and I visited her again yesterday, and I'm going to take her dinner in this evening before service. And can I confess to you something? I personally think that I'm 61-year-old man almost. I underestimated the worth of my mama and the value of my mama. And it's sad that I didn't realize how smart she really was. She's a wonderful woman. I wouldn't be in this pulpit today if it wasn't for her prayers and her heart for me and her love for me. And I want you kids, if you got your mama, she's living, you give her a big hug tonight. You tell her you appreciate her. And if you're away, they're away from home, you're away from home, you give them a call and stay on the phone more than 3 minutes. How about that? And love them a little bit. Let me give you five things about Lois and Eunice's faith that you could give to your children. Number one, mothers need to be concerned about the salvation of their children. In verse 1, Paul, apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, according to the promise of life which is in Christ Jesus. You want to know why Timothy got saved? Timothy had a grandma that prayed for him. And Timothy had a mom that instructed him. Somebody say amen. I want to tell you what, I'm saved because of my mom's prayers, and my two kids are saved because of Marguerite. I want to tell you, it's not because I'm a preacher and because of me, it's because of that mama that was faithful teaching them every day of their life. Jesus was real and God was real. As I was out working the church and ministering the church and leaving all hours of the night, I had a wife back there that was giving Christ to her kids, led both of them to Jesus. I want to tell you, it's real. Mamas, thank God for you. You're the heart of the home. You're the soul of the home. You're really what gives the home its life. Come on, somebody help me. I just don't think we teach that enough. I think we've got so intimidated by political correctness, by the feminists. Come on, help me. And by that bunch of liberals that try to dictate and dear God, I may not agree with Governor Romney's faith. I don't. But I dare not say his wife hadn't worked a day in her life. What kind of idiot would say that about a woman that raised five boys and stuck by the stuff? Could have done anything she wanted to, but she decided to do that. And listen to me, I don't agree with his faith. I don't agree with his doctrine, but I want to tell you what, I'm not going to slam his wife for being a homemaker. I won't slam you if you're a homemaker. I'm not slamming you work outside the home. God bless all of you. It's got to the point in our country is to divide our nation and pit one another against you. Thank God for working mothers. Thank God for mothers that work at home. God bless you. Because the salvation of your children is the most important thing that you'll get from a relationship. And mama, you're the key to that. That's what happened with Lois, and that's what happened to Eunice. They decided that Timothy needed to get saved, and they had that in their heart. Hey, I wonder how many of you moms are more concerned about your kids' other education and your kids' extracurricular activities, and you forgot that they got a soul, and they need to go to heaven, and this needs to be taught in the home. Somebody help me. Amen. So number one, we need mothers to be concerned about the salvation of their children. I want to tell you what, I'm glad my two kids were saved. I'm glad I know that. Number two, in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 2 through 4, mothers need to be concerned about the spiritual well-being of their children. I want to tell you what, somebody help me. Mamas, if you don't, us dads are going to miss them because we're so busy with life and goofing around. Thank God for mothers that are interested in the spiritual well-being of their children. Hey, by the way, my mama, when I got called to preach, she told me, she said that was an answer to prayer. She lived the Christian life before me. I know I disappointed her a whole bunch, but I want to tell you, thank God for mothers that, hey, you know why Timothy ended up a preacher? You want to know why Timothy ended up right with God? Because mama was interested in his spiritual well-being. Now, I'll tell you what, I was interested a lot with my kids. God help me, and I didn't get it. But I love to see James shoot a three-pointer. Man, I was up there screaming, shouting, carrying on like an idiot. Almost went to jail in Hearts. That's a long story. And that was important to me. You know, us guys, we kind of live our second childhood through our kids. We do that, and you can go ahead and get mad at me if you want to, but that's a fact. But thank God for mamas that can look beyond that. And ain't nothing wrong with us enjoying it. James enjoyed it. But I thank God for moms that look beyond that. They want not only the spiritual well-being. My wife would always lecture me when I got a little out of balance with that athletic stuff. And by the way, I love it right now. If Lord have mercy, I might go to a ball game this afternoon. I love it. But you hear me out. Margaret Reed said, when I start getting over the edge, she said, that's becoming too important to you. And I feel about that high. And she's over with the Bible, talking to the kids and instructing them and tell them there's more important things in life than a basketball and a football. Hello. And you know who does that? While we were out running around working and carrying on, guess who's in the home making sure the kids are spiritually right and doing right? Mama, thank God for you. Number three, in verse 5, mothers need to be concerned about the spiritual example they are setting for the children. Look at verse 5. When I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, I am persuaded that it is in thee also. By the way, you know how to get your children to serve God? Being an example to them. Now, I bet you, most of you don't know who my wife is. My wife is not somebody in this church that's going to run around and say, look at me. She gets real mad at me when I point her out. But this morning, I am going to point her out. Miss Smith, stand. Marguerite Smith, stand. There she is. That's my queen. You say, she go, yeah. She knows somebody around here that she doesn't run her mouth. She hasn't in 34 years caused me any damage. But I'll tell you what she has been. example. First of all, to them kids. And secondly, to the ladies of this church. You know, here running their mouth, embarrassing me or embarrassing. Somebody help me. How many thinks that's important? Somebody say amen. Somebody needs to be an example. It starts with you, lady. Hey, ladies, you can be an example. Your kids need to see that. That's where that's why Timothy was the man that he was. He had an example. Amen. I've never in 34 years had anybody one time say, boy, your wife, she dressing like a heathen. Hello. Boy, your wife, she's a motor mouth. She's a gossip. She's the meanest woman in West Virginia, but she ain't none of them other things. You need to be an example. We really don't have, I don't have any grandchildren yet, and we're still believing God's going to give us grandchildren. But I want to tell you, she's got a whole bunch of them in this church right here. She's grandmama to about a bunch of kids in this church. Amen. She just is. She just is. She's also grandma to a goat and 24 chickens and 3 donkeys. That woman's something. She's an example. Doesn't complain. Doesn't fuss. But she always looks about my well-being and the children's well-being. Thank God for that. Oh, mama, thank you. Thank you for being that kind of woman. Thank you for setting that kind of example. Somebody say amen. You know what's missing in our country? That's missing in our country. Now we have a bunch of heathen women out there, a feminist acting like a bunch of bozos. They're getting all their attention. But I want to tell you, the people that needs to get applause this morning is those that's in this room that love God, that love morality, that love values, that lift up Jesus, that live an example for God, that believe there's a hope ahead. That's the people that ought to get our applause this morning. Amen. Not some windbag that's acting like a devil every day. Amen. Hallelujah. Number 4, verse 6. Well, I'm going to really spend a minute on this one. Wherefore I put in remembrance that thou stir up the gift of God which is in thee by the putting on of my hands. Number 4. Mothers need to be concerned about promoting Christian service to their children. Because I'm going to be honest with you. Us men, here's what we're interested in. Well, here, we're interested in they get a good job. They get this and that. Mama, thank God for you this morning. You know why Timothy got in the ministry? Because mama prodded him. Mama saw the potential. As a lot of us dads, we're not there. We're so concerned about the physical. We're concerned about the physical that we are not concerned about the spiritual. And sometimes we even get ugly with our wife when they're more concerned about spiritual things than we are. Somebody help me preach right there. Hey, let me say something. There's some of you parents, and I'm going to be really transparent right now. You parents, look at me. We've got one of the greatest groups of young people we've ever had in the history of this church. Are you listening to me? Are you hearing me? And for them to go to the next level, to a full-time Christian service, it's just going to take a little bit of promoting from you. I'm not trying to call your kids into full-time Christian service. I'm not trying to call them to preach. But I want you to know something. If God's trying to do it, you ought not to hinder it. You ought to promote it. You ought to thank God. If church is more important than their basketball, Hallelujah. That church is more important than a golf game? Hallelujah. That church is more important than a baseball? Hallelujah. If they're really bent towards serving God, promote it. Push it. Mama, you got more sense than your husband. You keep doing that. Because us men, we just eat. We eat up with it. I'm beating me up. I know. You said, boy, you're really giving women too much credit. No, they're the heart of the home. Lastly, and I'm done. Mothers need to be concerned, lastly, about encouraging spiritual boldness in their children. In verse 7, for God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind. Spiritual boldness. Hey, listen, you can make a difference, mama. You got more influence in that home than even daddy does. And you can help your kids have spiritual boldness. You can say, hey, honey, speak out for God. Jeff, I don't know if you was there or not. A couple Wednesday ago, your daughter sang. I'm not sure if you were there or not. She's graduating. I can't hardly believe it. And she gave a testimony, a current one, of how God was blessing her life. And she's not the only one. We got a bunch of kids in this room. They love God. You parents, you got kids that love God. Somebody help me here. Don't be upset about their boldness. It thrills me when they're bold. It thrills me when they're serving God. It thrills me. Some of these young boys are getting up and doing devotion. Somebody ought to run around here and shout glory. We need to promote them to be bold. We need to promote them and say you can make a difference in society. This society's going down. It's a mess. And we need to raise up a generation of champions. And it starts right in the home. And mama, you're the heart of the home. Stand with me with heads bowed and eyes closed. I want to ask a question. To mothers, but to everyone. How many of you right now, if you died today, you're 100% sure you place your faith in Christ Jesus? Raise your hand if you know that.